So we'll go ahead and start again by setting our motivation, reviving it. Sanghe Chodom Soghi Chodom Lai Janchu Padu Dane Kapsu Chi Dagi Chunyan Ki Pe Sonam Ki Drola Penchi Sanghe Drupa Sho Sanghe Chodom Soghi Chodom Lai Janchu Padu Dane Kapsu Chi Dagi Chunyan Ki Pe Sonam Ki Drola Penchi Sanghe Drupa Sho Sanghe Chodom Soghi Chodom Lai Janchu Padu Dane Kapsu Chi Dagi Chunyan Ki Pe Sonam Ki Drola Penchi Sanghe Drupa Sho. Reconnecting. So we left off looking at self-cherishing and looking at the cowardly crow, or ourselves when we're under the influence of self-cherishing more prominently, and how that makes our world kind of collapse and become small, and all sorts of things that normally wouldn't worry us, you know, when you get a bit sort of fragile or irritable or easily annoyed, and then it easily escalates into bigger, coarser negative states of mind. These are all little symptoms of self-cherishing really blossoming in a horrible, beautiful way. So identifying it is key. And so we do reflections like that to really understand experientially the difference between ourselves when self-cherishing is a bit in the background or dormant and not really driving us as much as obviously, and when self-cherishing is really in charge and rolling the whole show out. So we always have self-cherishing until we have bodhicitta. Yeah, uncontrived bodhicitta, spontaneous bodhicitta. We always have self-cherishing. And, you know, self-grasping is something that we will have also at this point in our development, and they reinforce one another, but eventually we can get rid of them both. So when you're identifying self-cherishing or identifying your inner cowardly crow, do you feel comfortable to share kind of the symptoms that will help you catch it when you know that it's driving? Are there things that happen to you kind of physically, or your verbal behavior, or some of your mental behaviors that are obviously not you at your best, that you can kind of go, oh, self-cherishing is driving?
I was just thinking, it's when I start thinking, I this, I that, I the other. And I think, oh, yes, it's a good starting point. I just wondered if that was useful.
Absolutely. Yeah. Or like, what about me? That. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And doesn't anyone understand how much I dot, dot, dot work hard, suffer tons, am amazing, am horrible. But yeah, very centralized on the self. I really like the distinction sort of verbally between self-conscious, which is like self-cherishing, and self-aware. And that's what's so tricky in Buddhism, isn't it? Because you're trying to cultivate this mindfulness that's very self-aware, that is really understanding what you're doing, why you're doing it, what's happening around you, and what motivation you're bringing to it. Is so essential. That's self-aware, yes? But self-conscious is, and what does everyone else think about that? Yeah. And am I being judged harshly, or am I being celebrated properly? And does everyone notice me? I hope no one notices me. I think everyone's looking at me. I hope everyone's looking at me. Self-conscious, yeah. You know, and self-consciousness can look like arrogance and pride, but it also can look like self-loathing and depression and low self-esteem, because both are equally I. Yeah, it's just one is more painful than the other, at least in the moment of its arising. So we trend different ways, you know, if you think about the three poisons, anger, attachment, ignorance, we kind of trend with one when we're hungry, tired, overworked, bit burnt out. We kind of have a default one that's our go-to. And it might be that we stay professional and polite and generally nice enough, but there's a rumble under the surface. So what your internal rumble is important to catch. You know, if you're kind of more of a trending towards ignorant time, it's more kind of vague, kind of vague out, a bit off in space, you're a bit disassociated. If you come around a corner and someone else is there, you go, you know, you get easily startled because you're just really not in your body, really not present. That, if you default more anger, then you're just a little annoyed all the time. Yeah. And you're just like ready to pick at things, you know, and why do people, why can't they just picking? Yeah. And if you're more attached type, then you kind of go into a bit of a kind of a sooky, sort of a fragile, needy, you know, kind of a place that's got kind of an ambiance of melancholy and sadness, or might be quite kind of excitable and chasing entertainment and sensory experiences and like feeding the senses, you know, feeding the eyes, feeding the mouth, feeding the ears. You know, you can't have silence in the house. You have to have the TV on or music on. You know, you have to be reading something or watching something or eating something all the time. That, so the attachment type can kind of trend sad or hungry or hungry sad, depending on the day. So the thing is like, it's not you, it's just habit. So figure it out, you know, where does your afflicted side land? And then if you can catch the tiny version of it, sometimes just noticing it, it dissolves. And you don't even need another antidote. You don't need to think about the wheel of sharp weapons returning. You don't need to remember being the peacock in the poison grove. You don't have to think, oh no, I'm a cowardly crow. You don't have to go into a whole analysis. You can just use the fact that you have analyzed and watch the present moment dissolve back into your better side. But that only works if it's little. If it's really escalated and you've become intoxicated with the negative state of mind, it's much harder to move through it quickly. So the self-cherishing little monster inside of us, the demon, the thief who steals our peace and our kindness, that wall around our heart, all of that kind of way of thinking about it, you have to really look at the way part of you still believes it's helping you. Yeah, because it's easy enough to see the damage it does. We're smart people. We're introspective people. We are relatively self-aware people, or we wouldn't come to a Dharma class, right? But how to see the fact that there's part of you that feels like it's your protector, or it's your shield, or it's helping you save your energy, or it's helping you protect your peace, or somehow self-cherishing still kind of feels like a friend, even though it's a liar. So finding then, okay, what do I say to myself that indulges the self-cherishing thought? Sometimes it's as simple as not remembering impermanence and death. And self-cherishing says, don't remember change. Don't remember that you're going to die. Just find comfort today. Yeah, you're allowed to have comfort today. And forget about the fact that you've done this every day and your whole life just races by in a series of comfort techniques and entertainment strategies and avoiding conflict, you know, because for one day, it's not that big a deal. Forgetting that self-cherishing gives us permission to do that every day and then our life is wasted. Yeah. And we are on our deathbed and we think, oh, what was it all for? What was it all leading towards? What's the legacy I'm leaving behind in my relationships? You know, so if you can remember death, it can actually break the spell of self-cherishing a little bit when it's lying to you and saying, oh, but you can deserve a little comfort today, sweetie. You've been working so hard. Have a snack, have a rest, put your feet up, which is not to say you're not allowed to have a snack, put your feet up and rest. You should. It supports joyous effort. You must have breaks. You must have breaks before you burn out. A bodhisattva is wise, not just compassionate. You must have breaks. Do you hear me? It's the way that self-cherishing tells you you can do it that's negative. So again, it's not the action so much that's in question. It's your motivation behind it. sometimes we only allow ourselves to rest if we've proven that we're a good little worker long enough to be tired, resentful, and burnt out. Then we're allowed to rest. We have permission to rest because now we're sick. Now we have adrenal fatigue. Now we have a headache. Now whatever. Now we're allowed to rest because we worked hard enough to hurt ourselves. This is not the way we want to think. This is some nonsense capitalist propaganda, whatever weirdness, something about look at me being a good little worker, which is not useful. And it's not sustainable, right? Because then you're just pushing, 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 and then fall apart. And then you have to pick yourself back up, recover, heal, spend all sorts of time and money in recovery and healing, kind of go into some sort of indulgence for a while, and then kind of get motivated to start again. And then you start again and you build momentum and faster, faster, more, 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 more burnout. Same thing again. And so much is lost by not being kind and humble enough to pace yourself in a practical way so that you don't have to recover from your life. Do you know what I mean? And so to not have to recover from your life, you need to have the sort of life that is very skillfully structured to have breath in it. Yeah. Conscious moments of recovery, recalibration, reconnection. So if you can think about the most ordinary of days, the most common of days, the things you do during the day, ask yourself which of the relief mechanisms are escape and which are recovery. Because the escape ones don't help you recover. They just delay the inevitable. And they're a little bit of a moment of some kind of soothing, some kind of peace. It's very normal and natural to turn to them, but they don't actually help us recover and reconnect. And when you do something as simple as a 5-minute shamatha meditation on the meditation object of your choice, the first 30 seconds are hell. But the 4.5 minutes after are very useful, sometimes easy, sometimes hard, sometimes both. But afterwards, you feel better. Yeah, and you don't need a giant siesta in the middle of the day. You actually could have just a little 5-minute recalibration. So remember that when you first change gears, it's uncomfortable. There's resistance, there's tension, there's avoidance, there's, I see my cushion, I do want to meditate, I like to meditate, meditation's hard, I'm not sure which one to do, maybe I'll just avoid it. Or here's all the things I should be doing, and that's completely overwhelming, so I'm just going to be paralyzed and do nothing. It's really normal, right? So being kind and humble enough to be simple is something we need to keep coming back to, because it actually helps us recover. And it allows for all of the amazing Dharma things we've heard to digest and to integrate and to become our own. So then when you speak Dharma to yourself, it sounds like you. It doesn't sound like the person you heard it from, but it's still accurate. Yeah. And that's how you know it's yours. It sounds like you in your head. Yeah. So self-cherishing seems to be the protector. It seems to be the helper, but it's the very thing that keeps you isolated or paranoid or alienated or irritable or needy. It's the very thing that does that under the guise of I'm protecting your energy and your time. So asking yourself, what is an escape behavior as opposed to what is a recovery behavior? You are allowed and should chase as much recovery as you can. Heal the body, heal the mind, keep it healthy. Do that. Do it a lot. Do all the things that help with that, both Dharma-wise and just worldly wisdom-wise. But the escapes, look at them with a bit more of a skeptical, maybe even cynical look, right? Just really look at them in the face and say, I said that this was relaxation, but actually it was escape. Yeah. And it's understandable that we'd want to escape, and we've only really been taught to escape from pain, not to move into it, through it, and out the other end, or to pause in such a way that we catch our breath again and can finish a process without hurting ourselves further. So it's understandable that we have all these strategies that don't work. But, you know, something as simple as the comfort of reading a book before bed, which is not negative or positive in and of itself, when the attachment mind, when the self-cherishing mind gets activated, you get needy, hungry energy with reading the book, even a Dharma book, and get upregulated and stay up too late and don't sleep properly. Right? How many times have we done something like that, right? And it could be actually a perfectly virtuous book or a novel or Harry Potter or whatever. It doesn't matter. Like, if you're approaching it with the wrong mindset, you get into that hungry mode. If you, I don't know, read one inspiring poem very slowly and mindfully, then you might go to bed, right? But, you know, it's just the way in which we're approaching the activities. Does that make sense? Yeah. So it's confronting to call yourself a coward, but you're not a coward. You're just a coward when you're a crow. You're also sometimes a peacock. Yeah. So if you can name the way there's a shrinking that happens in your life when self-cherishing is in charge, life shrinks. Your worldview shrinks. And the smaller your world is, the less it takes to upset you. So this is another way that self-cherishing hurts you, doesn't help you. Yeah. You know this all the time, I'm sure. When there's a wonderful thing happening in your life or a terrible thing happening in your life, that your world somehow is bigger and confronted in some way, all the tiny things can either matter more or less. Yeah. It can go either way. But you've probably had that experience where there's some like wonderful thing, like you've gotten a new job or a new partner or a new house, or there's a new baby or something new and exciting is happening. And then there's like a minor inconvenience and you just don't care. You don't care. You're like, whatever. Yeah. It's cool. It's amazing. And it shows what the mind can do. And then you start to take for granted those very things that made you so uplifted and inspired, and that tiny inconvenience can ruin your whole day. And you get so annoyed and you think, oh, the barking dog. Yeah, there was the same barking dog when you were happy, you just didn't care then. Yeah. I always have this conversation with myself about leaf blowers because I have some sort of karma to experience leaf blowers in every country I go to. I must have been a very noisy neighbor in a past life, and I'd like to apologize to everyone for being a noisy neighbor. But leaf blower karma is something I cop, or noisiness. And it is fascinating because if I'm in a good space, it's just white noise in the background. And I notice it for a minute, and then I just go back to what I'm doing. And if I'm in a bad space, it will drive me crazy. And I'll want to go outside and have a word with the person and, you know, and like, and how dare you, and think of all the petrol you're using, and just use a broom, and you know, whatever. And I get really like, you know, on it about it. The same exact noise can have many different effects. So we all have our example of that and how self-cherishing makes our world too small, and then little things get to us. Okay, so a bit more about this. Crows are analogous to cowardly beings. What makes us cowardly is the two enemies, self-grasping, self-cherishing. So when you're under the influence of these, especially in an escalated way, samsaric pleasures are poison. Yeah, so the good things are never enough, or the good things get distorted, or you seek the good things at the expense of others, because we use them with attachment and that leads us to suffer in the future. Okay, so the antidote to self-grasping is the wisdom realizing emptiness, and that's what we'll talk about tomorrow. The antidote to self-cherishing is bodhicitta, which we've been talking about. So just a quick note on self-grasping, but we'll come back to it. Self-grasping ignorance here, there's a lot of different kinds of self-grasping, but the type we're talking about here is the form that is the root of samsara, and it directs self-cherishing. So it's innate self-grasping that views the I in one's own mental continuum and holds it to exist inherently. So it views the I, the conventional I, the no problem I, and it superimposes or adds a characteristic that is completely not there. Yeah, it adds to this relative I a sense of inherence, meaning like self-created, like causeless, like partless, like permanent, like, you know, from its own side or existing by way of its own characteristics. It adds something that is not there. That's the ignorance that we're talking about. And then because of that, you have this self-cherishing that is the destructive way of caring for the self. So it looks after one's own welfare with indifference to others. And it takes no responsibility for alleviating their suffering. It looks after one's own welfare, even at the expense of others. It gets fragile and volatile with self-obsession. So the indifference one might seem more benign, but it's so pervasive, it becomes really problematic. So this one is, I think, the trap of nice people. Yeah, we're nice people. The trap of nice people is that we don't recognize how much indifference we have to people in just living our life and going through the day. We think, I'll just look after myself and I won't cause any trouble. I don't want to hurt anyone. I'm a nice person. I don't want to hurt anybody, but leave me alone. Yeah, don't bug me. And I'm certainly not going to go out of my way to help you. It's got that in the background unacknowledged, but the surface of it is, I'm just minding my own business. I'm not hurting anyone. Do you know that one? Like, it's polite, it's socially acceptable. You know, you're a conscientious citizen, but not really in a proactive, altruistic way, kind of in a little bit of a smug, self-satisfied way that can't be bothered. So we can fall into that really easily if we too much identify as, I'm a good person. You know, you are a good person, but you're also a bad person and a neutral person, and it changes moment to moment. Yes, you always have Buddha nature, not to fear, but your afflictions do get up to mischief. Own it, right? So that little sneaky one that's indifference is harder to catch than the one that is acting at the expense of others. That one usually has some sort of ramifications that are obvious to us soon enough. So just catching that little guy. So verse 5 says, how can someone who cherishes self more than others take lust and such dangerous poisons for food? If he tried like a crow to use other delusions, he would probably forfeit his chance for release. So the notes on this from Geshe Nawan Dargye, he says any of the delusions may be used in the Tantra system as an actual path to enlightenment. In the perfection vehicle, the delusions may only be used as a method for directly benefiting others when circumstances demand it. They may not, however, be practiced as an actual path. This is a point of some confusion of how do you actually use a delusion in any context. And in Tantra, you're not using the actual negative state of mind, like desire or hatred or ignorance. You're using the energy that accompanies it. So for example, you know, you see delicious food, attachment arises, the anticipatory bliss of the food, you know, you're like, this is going to be great when I have the food, sort of anticipation bliss arises. Now, you don't go with the attachment, you think, isn't it interesting that I can have a blissful mental experience before eating? Well, that must mean that the food itself isn't the cause of the bliss. Otherwise, I could only experience it once I ate it. That means it's a dependent arising. If it's a dependent arising, that shows the way it's empty of inherent existence. Ah, interesting. Not the food, just the mind. Maybe I could actually have a blissful mind divorced from even seeing the food, maybe unrelated to food altogether. Maybe I could just be happy, right? And maybe any condition could be a condition for that because the causes are my own mind. Frees you up, yeah, frees you up. But the problem is that because we don't have bodhicitta, we don't have renunciation, we don't have the correct view, is that we see the food, anticipate bliss, and then if anything gets in the way of actually eating it, we are enraged. Yeah, we are enraged. How dare you interfere with my happiness? Yes, and then we get to the food and we eat it so quickly, we don't even enjoy it because we've just got the hunger, you know? Not the regular hunger, but like the attachment hunger. Yes, I will merge with this happiness maker. And then afterwards, you feel tired and annoyed that it didn't work. Yeah. So it's a delicate process, but I think to really recognize also when you don't have the right mindset with your relationship to things that can be a condition for happiness, when there's a strong attachment relationship there that you sometimes don't notice until it's thwarted and then anger comes. How do you know attachment was present? Well, if you didn't get what your attachment wanted, were you mad? Yeah, it was attachment then. If you didn't get what you wanted and you weren't mad, maybe it was just a normal plan. Do you know the difference? Yeah. And you can feel it, especially like if you're waiting in line for food and you're a little bit hungry and someone cuts in front of you or there's a delay and you are mad. But none of us are starving. So is the mad about I'm going to die without this food? No, the mad is you thwarted my attachment. Yeah, it's fascinating to watch yourself and how upset you can get when attachment doesn't get what it wants. So thus bodhisattvas are likened to peacocks. They live on delusions, those poisonous plants. Transforming them into the essence of practice, they thrive in the jungle of everyday life. Whatever is presented, they always accept while destroying the poison of clinging desire. So when we say whatever is presented, they always accept, it's not an invitation to complacency. It's an invitation to relaxing into everything is workable, that mentality. When you see accept or take on, this is about your inner conversation. Yeah. And when your inner conversation is a healthy, effective one, then your outer behaviors are going to be unagitated, unafflicted, or at least less afflicted. So, you know, when something is difficult and you feel like you have to stand up for yourself, we're usually used to needing anger to get enough energy to work up the courage to stick up for ourselves. And we don't know how to stick up for ourselves unless we get angry about it first. But just because that's natural doesn't mean it's necessary, right? You can stand up for yourself from a place of compassion for yourself and compassion for others and compassion for everyone involved. And then there is more stability in your mind, whether you're, quote, successful or unsuccessful. Does it make sense? So you deal with your inner world and you get yourself to a place of peace. And then you, from your place of wisdom, say, here are the things that need to be addressed. I'm going to say them with my clearest, best communication and let go. And if it's going to work, it'll work. And if there's not enough conditions for it to work, it won't. But here's my best, let go. And then it's different than if you're sticking up for yourself out of anger and it doesn't work, then you're completely depressed or completely enraged, right? You implode or you explode. Because you had an attachment that said, if I stand up for myself, people will listen and it will work. You know, like as if people cooperate or are consistent, right? People are not consistent or reliable, bless their hearts, yes. So sometimes it works, but often it doesn't. Expect failure, you'll be more relaxed. Yes, which is not to say complacency. So having a mind of acceptance is this mind that says it's all workable. Not it's all good, but it's all workable. It's bad, that's workable. It's good, that's workable. It's indifferent, it's workable. It's neutral, it's workable. I can take everything that's happening on the path and I will try to address injustices when I see them, while still knowing that I don't know the whole spectrum of what makes an injustice, and I don't know the whole spectrum of the things that will help. I'll do my best and I'll let go. Does it make sense? So you're like assertive and detached at the same time, but not disengaged. You're fully engaged with life. The bodhisattva is fully engaged in daily life and in the samsaric appearances that they and others have and all the kind of worldly stuff that people get up to. But the mentality they bring to it is, how can I use this as fuel to open the heart? Yeah, and to build more connections. So those main themes then were peacocks as bodhisattvas, poison as the danger of living in a samsaric environment while having samsaric views, crows analogous to cowardly beings motivated by self-cherishing, self-grasping. Wheel of Sharp Weapons is our karma. Yama and Yamataka, Lord of Death and Slayer of the Lord of Death.
I just wanted to make a comment, really. I wish I could remember this stuff every day. You know, like, when things get on top and, it's hard to remember it all, you know, until sometimes you've just tipped over and then I think, I wished I could have remembered, you know, to do the right thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
I wish it was easy. And I think...
yeah, same. same.
Yeah.
But is it easier than it used to be?
Yeah, it is easier than it used to be. It is. Like I used to... I was a redhead. And people always say redheads have a pretty hot temper. Well, I was pretty quick to answer and pretty quick to, you know, so that, I guess it's old age really, but things have, you know, calmed down quite a lot and I don't react like I used to react.
Some people get more set in their ways, more grumpy, more hard-hearted, hard-headed. I think you can have that relaxing with age, but it's not inevitable, you know. Give yourself some credit. Right. Right.
Yeah. Okay. So, thank you.
What do you think are the things that make you remember the days you remember? What are the conditions that help you click back into the wisdom you have?
I think if I start the day well.
Yeah.
You know, and stick to my plan or, you know, variations of my plan.
Yeah.
When I don't, then I start thinking, what would you say? Why didn't I do that? I start questioning why I didn't do it. You know, so it kind of tips the day. You know, it tips it. Yeah. That's one of the things.
Yeah, the good launch. The good morning launch.
Yeah.
I think you're. I think you're 100% right. It's not like you can't salvage it if you had a rough morning, but it's harder to salvage it if you didn't set your day up in that way.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Do other people have thoughts about the things that do help them remember? I mean, of course, from a Buddhist perspective, repetition and familiarity are what makes you remember more often. So, you know, how do you not lose your life lessons? You repeat them to yourself on purpose, consciously and repetitively, they stick. But what else helps you guys?
We go to morning prayers. I mean, General Barbara is quite often there, and we have those sentences of the three levels of motivation. I find those are excellent. You know, today as much as possible, I will harm nobody with my, you know, body, speech, mind. I mean, they just set you up.
Yeah.
However you get up, you feel different after having said those. So yeah. I totally agree with what you said there. Thank you. And you
already believe it. You know, it's not like you're telling yourself things you don't already know and believe. It's just by saying them, you bring them to the forefront. And I think that's part of what happens to people that have understood intellectually the premise, that understanding is the end of the story. And for us, understanding is the beginning of the practice, not the end. Once you've understood, then you can repeat and deepen and integrate, you know? So I think the very fact that these prayers are repetitive is the thing that builds their power. And we have to kind of get over our kind of intellectual kind of Western thinking that thinks, I get it now, I'm done. And then you're disappointed that you don't live in accordance with what you've understood. You think, I understood that. Why do I keep doing the wrong thing? It's like, well, it's not familiar enough. You know, don't beat yourself up. You just have more habit of the wrong way. You know, turn the tide.
What I like about those sentences, the levels of motivation, is you're actually replacing whatever is in your mind with that.
Yeah.
And it's such a good place to start. So you're not just trying to stop something or get rid of something. You're actually putting something else in its place.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. It's like a preemptive strike against the afflictions of the day. Yeah. And I think, you know, mindfulness, breaks in the day, because to maintain bodhicitta mindfulness throughout the day is a hard ask for us at our level. So to say, you know, what are my times when I check back in and reconnect to my practice, even if I'm not even sitting properly, you know, is it when I turn on the kettle, you know, every time I go for a cup of tea, put the kettle on, have a moment of just come back to bodhicitta, you know, or in and out of doors is a good time, right? Moving from one room to the other or one activity to another. These moments of transition are a good opportunity to recalibrate, you know, just kind of like make it easier for yourself to remember what you value, yeah, and to deepen it. And, you know, and then when you're at the end of the day, we're used to the idea now probably of purification and purifying negative karma that we've created, whether it's in a casual reflective way or in a, you know, structured vajrasattva way. But to remember the rejoicing side too, you know, you purify and then think, what went well? How did I stay in alignment with my path? Yes, it's dependent arising. No, it's not fuel for pride. Be with the joy of having done some kindness in this world, even just some kindness towards yourself by not beating yourself up or by, you know, eating healthy or taking yourself for a walk or, I don't know, doing the recycling, whatever. You know, have some moments of rejoicing. I didn't yell at the spouse. I didn't, you know, whatever, you know, just be happy about the fact that you are really working hard on this path, even if it's not perfect.
This might seem a bit random. So last night I caught a spider, you know, gently, and I released it outside. And then afterwards, I sort of calmed myself down. It's all over. The spider is gone. But then I found myself thinking, well, is that self-cherishing by putting the spider outside? Like, do I feel like I deserve the space? I don't want to share the space with the spider, or am I going excessive? And then I thought, am I creating the condition to not be wanted in the future because somebody doesn't understand me? And I kind of got the answer, but I didn't like the answer because I'm quite afraid of spiders. So I thought I'd ask you.
Yeah. Well, I think it's showing that you get it, that it's not so simple, you know, that one action has many motivations that go bing, 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 bing so quickly. You know, so first motivation might be, I don't want to hurt you. I don't want you to hurt me. It's safer for both of us to be separated, right? So I shall escort you outdoors, dear kind mother sentient being spider. Goodbye. And then you're relieved and you think, phew, I got him out. I'm safe. Bugger you. I hope you're fine. Maybe you die. Maybe it's too cold. I don't care, but you're out of the house. You know, so now, okay, a little bit negative. And then you think, oh no, did I just create the cause for homelessness, to not be wanted, to have a bad relationship with that spider the next time we're both human? Oy vey, ah. You know, and you know, so it, like, all in like 10 seconds, you can have so many different karmas created. And the first thing you want to do is have a laugh at yourself, you know, and just think, aren't we funny? Like the way we justify and second guess and preempt and excuse and explain and just laugh at our absurdity and know it is mixed. You had good motivation, you had neutral motivation, you had bad motivation, and they all just kind of rolled through in a series of seconds, but the one you commit to is the one that's the most powerful. Yeah, so a lot of the incidental, like miscellaneous little thoughts and emotions and intentions that arise in your mind are very light karma. They're coming from the past. It's just, if you give in to the negative ones, you're creating a lot more suffering in the future. If they just pass through and you don't believe them, you don't give power to them, they just roll through. They're really not too big a deal. So what you want to say is, my motivation was mixed. Yes, there was something in it for me, but also there was my good heart that genuinely didn't want to hurt him and knew that if we were in the room together, I would have anxiety, be less effective the next day because of my lack of sleep. I might roll over on him. I might swallow him. I might smoosh him. That's not good for him. He'll be okay outside. It's win-win. It's fine. Right? You know, stuff like that. So the fact that you know that your motivation wasn't pure is a really good sign. Because what we can do is to think this action by its nature is inherently good. And it's like, there's good to it, but we're more complex than that. Yeah. Yeah. So many, many karmas happen, run right after the other. The ones that you give power to are the ones that have strength. So with the meditation that we did this process of going through equalizing and exchanging self for others, which then ends at Tonglen, which we haven't done yet. So this process of equalizing and exchanging self for others is a logical exercise. And then when you get to Tonglen, it's kind of the inevitable conclusion of those series of thoughts. And it becomes a bit more visualizing, a little less analytical. So I'll go through those stages with you briefly, and then we'll call it a day and do Tonglen tomorrow. So the conclusion of our verses so far is practice equalizing and exchanging. So here they are. You first have to equalize. So am I equal to others? Are my needs equal to others? How are we same, or how are we equal? And you can do this in any number of ways. You can think, all right, well, we are the same in wanting happiness, not wanting suffering. That's the first thing traditional Tibetan teachers will tell you. And probably the first time you hear it, you think, yeah, that sounds about right. Easy enough, common sense. And then you might think about it for a couple beats and go, yay, but what about that one guy? He doesn't seem to want happiness. What he does is nuts. That seems like he's chasing suffering. He loves his suffering. He's identified with his melancholy. He wants to be a struggling artist. He doesn't want happiness. Yeah, that's not true. Not all sentient beings want happiness. Yeah. But what's being talked about is the deep contentment. Yeah, that deep contentment. And even like the struggling artist with their melancholy who chases their pain likes the identity of that. Yes. So it's some sort of a contentment together with an odd kind of affect. Does it make sense? Yeah. So everyone wants happiness in many various types and shades and ways, but we seek happiness. We avoid suffering. You think, oh, that's not true. What about that couple that's into sadomasochism? They seem to like the pain, blah, blah, blah. You know, we want to avoid pain. We're talking about deep mental pain, and we might even chase some forms of pain to like resolve and kind of figure out and process previous moments of pain and trauma. We might kind of want to go back to the pain and see if we can figure it out somehow, so we remanufacture it. We're complicated creatures, man. We all need therapy. But there's a very, very deep subtlety that is seeking contentment and happiness and seeking to avoid suffering and pain. And so if you see it with like an insect, it's much easier. If you put a little breadcrumb in front of an ant, they're like, ooh, yum. And if you tap your finger on the desk, they go, eek, scared. You know, that's very obvious to see. People are complicated. But if you can use yourself as the guinea pig, that's the way. Okay, so do you think, do I in every moment want happiness despite the behaviors that may not lead to it? Every little movement on my cushion, trying to get comfortable. Everything that I consume, trying to get pleasure or peace or nourishment. Every little, you know, tweak of this or adjustment of that, trying to avoid some kind of discomfort and pain. Yeah, that's poignant and true, even if it's kind of in the background and I'm not really aware of it, and it's not verbal intentions. It's background intentions that are always there. If I'm to think of other people being driven the same way, it's easier to forgive them. They're just trying to get happy. And they're unskillful and confused about the methods, but they just want to be happy. Or they want to avoid pain and suffering. And who am I to fault them for trying to achieve those basic needs? I can fault the strategies they use if they're ineffective and harm others, but the basic drive is not so different than mine. So that sameness, thinking of that first reasoning, everyone wants happiness, no one wants suffering, can help you hit the spot of kind of affinity. But if it doesn't, don't worry about it, use a different one. Yeah, think, okay, what else is the same? We all have Buddha nature. How do we all have Buddha nature? We all have a consciousness which is empty of inherent existence. Because it's empty of inherent existence, it can change, develop, transform, and perfect. Yeah. If it were inherent, we would be as we are and we could never change. Nothing would influence us and we could influence nothing. And we've seen change over the course of our life. So why would that end? Especially if it was self-directed kind of an evolution. So all sentient beings have Buddha nature. That's same. Or all sentient beings have innate ignorance. Also same. Unfortunate. Yeah. So you can do good news or you can do bad news. Yes. Or neutral news, you know, all sentient beings have consciousness. Yeah. Clear and knowing consciousness, able to cognize and hold its object. They all have that. So whatever is going to get you into whatever the surface presentation is of, you know, gender or ethnicity or economic status or, you know, whatever, all that surface stuff is important and relevant to navigate and be sensitive to and kind. But at the very root of things, we are the same. Yeah. Do you feel that? Like there are surface differences and there's prejudices and lack of justice in all sorts of ways, the way people view one another, but at the very depths, we're the same. Yeah. And then you shift and you think, but what isn't the same is the amount of time I spend thinking of myself as opposed to thinking of others. I think of myself way more than I think of others, but there are way more of others. Right? So you just take a minute to kind of confront yourself gently. Yeah, just gently and say, look, it makes sense that I think about myself the most because I'm with myself the most time. But do I need to think so much, so often? And actually doing so, doesn't it increase the specifics of my needs in a way that makes me really unsatisfied? Yeah. Like if you're loving your life and you're enjoying your purpose and the meaning and connections in your life and food arrives for lunch, you're like, oh, good, food for lunch, eat, moving on. If you're not loving your life, if you're not feeling connected and purpose, then lunch is really important. And you're like, what is it today? What are the specifics of the day? What can I do to make it better? What spices, what seasonings? This is the wrong amount. This is too much. This is not enough. And you become very tight about specifics. Yeah. Do you know that feeling, right? When you get really specific about your needs, open back up. Yeah. Purpose, meaning, bodhicitta. Then food comes, yay, nourishment, moving on. Yeah. So if you're thinking about the more I think of myself, actually, the more I suffer. I need to do the checklist or the tick list of my basic needs. I absolutely need to look after myself, but not in a tight, fixated, specific, overly precious way. Just get the job done, happily move on. Yeah. And when you're thinking of others, you have to think of others without expectations. The expectation comes from some sort of ego need for performance, right? So you're working for the welfare of all sentient beings. And then your ego comes in and looks for, is it working? Are they watching? Do they like me? Where's the applause? Yeah. If you're just in, I'm working for the welfare of sentient beings, sometimes it'll be useful, sometimes it won't. I don't know everything. I don't have control over everything, but it's nice to live in this worldview. Do you know what I mean? So then you're starting to shift. Yeah, you're equalizing and starting to exchange self-cherishing for cherishing others because it's in everyone's best interest. It's the wise selfishness. So then you move to looking at the disadvantages of self-cherishing. When you're looking at the disadvantages of self-cherishing, you can look at them from any number of perspectives, but you're just trying to come to the conclusion that self-cherishing has disadvantages. Yes. So however it gets you there into some place of resonance, stay with it, let it hit home. Yeah, do the disadvantages first. And then you shift to what are the advantages of cherishing others. However gets you there, the way that it's helped in your life, the way that you've seen it help others' lives, the way that it helps humanity, just really try and make it real and personal and deep. And then you decide to actually exchange self for others or self-cherishing for cherishing others and land on, this is the way I want to live. And the result of all of that is then you go into Tonglen practice. And Tonglen practice has any number of verses that we'll go over tomorrow. And, you know, if you're not in the mood to do analytical meditation, remember that you can do these as structured thinking projects while you're walking the dog, okay? Don't feel like that's not Dharma, okay? You have the wisdom of hearing that you're developing right now in class through study. then you want to have the wisdom of reflection or contemplation, which is just rolling it around in your own mind with your own logic, with your own experience, and seeing how it lands. And then you meditate and bring it home and integrate and digest. So that power of reflection piece, it can be a conversation with a friend. It doesn't have to be the fancy monks and nuns on the debate courtyard doing their structured debate. It can be a conversation. And if you have no Dharma friend to have the conversation with, have the conversation with yourself. Yes. And just, you know, kind of walk around going, wait, that one day that was so bad, I was blaming all these external things, but it was my mind. It was my mind. How embarrassing. You know, just like walk around talking to yourself. It helps. Yeah. You can do it quietly so you don't scare your housemates. Yes. But like, just have a think. And it helps to have thought projects. Yeah, if you have things that you do every day, like walking the dog or doing the dishes, I suppose you'll have dishwashers, but, you know, chores, exercise, give yourself a Dharma thought project. It kind of takes the pressure off of feeling like it needs to be a formal meditation. And just kind of let your mind play with the idea a bit and see if you have insights or doubts or both. And then you can bring those back to your study. Yeah. And when you do that enough times, then you can meditate on it because you're familiar enough with the whole premise that it's going to actually touch you. Yeah. All right, so we'll call it a day and go ahead and dedicate using some of the verses and then the regular dedications as well. So thus, accepting ourselves, all deluded, non-virtuous actions that others have done in the past, in the present, and the future with mind, speech, and body, may delusions of others as well as our own be the favored conditions to gain our enlightenment, just as the peacocks eat poison and thrive. As crows may be cured after swallowing poison by a powerful antidote given in time, let's direct to all others our virtuous merit that this may replenish their chances for freedom. May all sentient beings reach Buddhahood soon. May the supreme jewel bodhicitta that has not arisen arise and grow, and may that which has arisen not diminish, but increase more and more. May the precious view of emptiness that has not arisen arise and grow, and may that which has arisen not diminish, but increase more and more. The wish-granting, wish-fulfilling jewel, source of every single benefit and happiness in this world, the incomparably kind Supreme Tenzin Gyatso, may you have a long life and all your holy wishes be spontaneously fulfilled. You who uphold the subduer's moral way, who serve as the bountiful bearer of all, sustaining, preserving, and spreading Manjunath's victorious doctrine, who masterfully accomplish magnificent prayers honoring the three sublime ones, savior of myself and others, your disciples, please, please live long. And if you like this text, I've taught it a few times in retreat format and kind of longer format, so you can find those on my YouTube channel. But tomorrow we'll talk mostly about ultimate bodhicitta and emptiness and Tonglen as well, and we'll do more meditation.